So hi everyone, my name is Yaroslav. I am backend engineer at Wix. And today I want to present a way how you can apply functional programming in your day-to-day work. So first of all, I want to ask an important question. How many of you write in purely functional application in your day-to-day work? Nice. So, okay. Most of application contains of two conceptual parts. One of, okay. Most of applications consist of two conceptual parts. First one is the model. It's a bunch of almost logicless case classes. And the second one is the your business logic. Business logic binds your model like a glue all together. So let's imagine we are going to write a new application. We have defined our model and specified our business logic using natural language. And then we need to define how our application should operate. So first consideration, let's make our application synchronous, because it's easier to develop. Why not? Now we should decide how should we handle errors? Should we use try or either or throw an exception? How should we propagate the context? We can use like the usual answer is to use thread locals, but it doesn't work well when we try to do some async stuff. Also, synchronous code sucks resources like crazy and we can't scale well. So let's try to do an asynchronous application. Let's build it on top of future, and then we are going to pollute all our signatures with execution context. We can use cat's effect IO, but it's not released yet, and we can't rely on it on its API. We can use Moniz task or even ScalaZ8 IO that is not released. And here we have again a question: how should we propagate this context? Because how should we propagate context of our request? Because in a synchronous application, we can't rely on thread locals, and we should use some specific execution context that will copy our thread locals from one thread to another, or even use reader team demona transformer to carry out this context. Okay. So we have so many options we need to decide on such early stage how we should operate. Some of you can think, stop, Yaroslav, what are you talking about? It's not a business logic, it's implementation details. Yes, and you're absolutely right, but the way we choose is going to influence our way we write in business logic. Also, I want to point that all of you are good engineers because you already translated your product guy wishes, your business wishes into computer language. But why should you care about executions and exceptions? I believe all of you want to work with concepts like take that value, take this value, combine them, and try to raise the error if something wrong, instead of call that method, get future back, flat map on that future using provided execution context, and return future fail if something wrong. So choosing a container is hard, and we should delay this choice as much as possible. And why I want to show you how easy, intuitive, and safe could be writing purely functional application, which empowers you with all FP benefits like totality, referential transparency, equation reasoning, and can directly benefit you as a developer and benefits your business. So I have prepared some examples. It's our simple model application, which we are going to turn in purely functional code. So we have this model like company and car. Company can rent cars. So we have a list that represents cars that are rented by company, and car which has ID and some specific car information. Also, we have two traits. Those are represent the way we can store and retrieve our companies and cars. So it's easy get set interface traits. And now we have our API. Our API defined by our business. So first method is the method that can using company ID retrieve the company name for some UI, I don't know. The second one is the method that can retrieve the list of cars with additional information rented by company ID. And the third one is the method that can add car as rented to some company by company ID, but if this company already rented this car, it should fail with exception. So I have used here try for handling errors, and everything is in for comprehension, so it's easy to compose and easy to see. And okay, so the approach I want to introduce is called tagless final. It's the way when you abstract over your container in which you operate and try your and write your code in the manner with abstract container. So you should apply two step to your like regular code base to apply this pattern. So first one, you should to abstract over container in your traits. So you are not returning try or future anymore. You're returning some f and the value inside this f. This is called hierarchy under types, and it means that it's container for new it's constructor for new types. And as a result, we have this abstracted f, but we when we call this method using this trait, we can't rely on what f means, because we have no information. We can't call any method. So we need to tell somehow to compilers that we want have some specific method on this f. And for example, yeah. So for example, we have this first method that is map our company and get our company by ID and retrieves its names. And it is using functor abstraction from cats. Functor means we can map something. So you don't need to know category theory or some like applied math. All you need is just to understand that functor is just the things that tell compilers that f can map. That's all. And we can implement this our method get company name purely in terms of cats type classes using functor. And now this method is totally decoupled from the concrete f. So it's not IO, it's not task, it's just f. So let's try to implement the second method. Second method should retrieve by company ID the list of cars those are rented by this company. So we can't use functor anymore because we can't. We receiving on find company the value inside f, and we can't use map to take every car ID and retrieve using it car, because we will have as a result f car. So, but there is also an abstraction for that called monad. Monad is just the things that gives us a capability to use for comprehension. You don't need, again, know the category theory or something else. You just write that f should be a monad, and you have all power to use for comprehension in your day-to-day job and code. Okay, so far so good, but and still we abstracted over the actual container. We just say that we want to FB a monad, and that's all. Okay, next attempt is a hard one with exceptions. And now we want to implement third method add car, which means that we want to add car, but if car already rented by this company, we want to raise error. There is a dedicated type class for that in cats called monad error. Monad error is the type class that means that this monad can raise error of some specific type. I use this type alias to partially apply this type class to throwable. So we just saying then that monad error with some abstract f and error of type with errors throwable. This is a throwing exception monad, and we just saying that F should be a throw in exception monad, and we are ready to implement our third method when we raise exceptions, and all of this in totally agnostic way how our container is operating. So we don't know nothing about F, we're just saying that please compiler, give us a proof that this F can have capability to raise exceptions, and that's all. Okay, now I want to show you some demonstration. I have implemented some steps for car ops and company ops. It's our repositories for car and company. And now I want to show you that I didn't change anything in our API, in our business logic place, and I can run it using future, like easy. Okay, it's worked. It add new car to new car as rented to company. I didn't change anything, so now we move forward using another container called IO from cats. So again, what I want to highlight that I didn't change anything. Now I just say that I want to run this code in IO, and that's all. It's right. It's running in IO, and it works. So our business logic is totally decoupled. It doesn't know anything about the container, just about capabilities it needs to operate. And one advanced case is when we want to propagate context. It's common thing that we want to propagate, I don't know, request IDs or some authentication info through our call stack. But we don't want to pollute everything with this context. And in the same time, we want to be in type-safe land. We don't want to rely on some thread locals that should be populated by someone. We want just compiler to prove us that we have context, that we run this context, and extract context only on needs, not everywhere. So again, our business logic is totally unchanged. It's the same. But now our target monad is a reader IO, which means that we are going to carry the string in every call, but in the same way, we have standard monad instances from cats, so we don't need to pollute in this case, in case of our monad error, and we can abstract in, for example, our repository this request ID and print it out. So let's run. And as you see, we didn't see it. Okay, sorry. Yeah. So as a result, as always, code didn't change. It's the same. But now we carry some additional context. So we have this output, which means that print some message on every method of repository, and it's a great power, because in fact in Wix we're using this in project where I'm working, we're using this for propagating tenant ID, and we have some specific logic for tenant on places in the end of the world near databases or near APIs, and our general logic is not polluted by ID. We just write it in agnostic toggles final manner, and then just use the IDs in the end of our application. So, yeah, you can think about that like this, but in fact, it's very easy and intuitive. You just define your capabilities of your code using type classes from libraries like cats or ScalaZ. So here is a simple tooltip. Which type class can represent which capability. So if you want to change structure of your case class, like you have company map to email, you can use functor. If you want to have capability to parallel compose, so take from two repositories in parallel, you can use applicative. But in cats, there is a dedicated class called parallel, which enforce you. If you want to have capability to compose effectful functions of the functions, those that returns some value inside F, you can use a monad. For error handling, you can use an applicative error or monad error. Also, there is a dedicated library called cats effect for effect handling. So you can't just put your effect in F. So effect under effect, I mean side effects. So if you have some side effect in operations, like putting in database, and there is a dedicated library called cats effect that defines type classes for handling this effectful operation. So you can in safe and guaranteed functional manner put some side effect in operation inside F. Okay. Also, you can use reader to for context propagation and much more type classes from cats to describe other capabilities. So what we got in the end? Everything is purely functional, total, and deterministic, and it has no side effects. This gives an unprecedented ability to reason about your software merely looking at your type signature. We have an ability to control flow itself using type classes. As a result, we do have a specification of every component and proof of correct composition of our components is proved by is done by rich Scala compiler. So we can more and more enforce in our types and have more guarantees about our software. Also, it's easy to test. In fact, there is interesting tip that when we are programming in such style, there is no unit method anymore because we don't have unit methods. We have only F unit, and it means that we don't need to verify anything in when we mock our dependencies. We always need to mock it. We don't need to verify. It's like nice proof that it's functional because every function now returns value. We don't have unit functions anymore. Also, there is nice IDE support instead of macros that are generating. Those are generating free monads. Typeless finalist has much more better support than. Also, there is the if you are writing such style. There is a problem with putting much more code in as pure functional and move your side effects out of your code, because in code that is doing side effects, you have no proofs that functional program gives to you. So there are a bunch of libraries. Those can help you to move your effect. Side effect and code inside of them, and they will control it for you. So HTTP and HTTP4C are for dealing with the HTTP. FS2 is for streaming. Dubi is the syn JDBC wrapper. Upper bound is the rate limiter, and Monix is a nice library with very good documentation you can use. It could be like your target monad. Thank you.
I have a question, if you don't mind.
It's light and talk.
Okay.
Should I show you?
No. Okay. This approach with effect extraction and type classes, do you recommend it to change always instead of explicit futures or tries or anything like that? Do you think this is a future, it is better, and it's best for Scala developers?
I think it's better, yeah. From my personal experience and opinion, yeah, I think it's better, because when you write in your code, you don't think about future. Because when you watch on some functions that returns future, what does it mean? It means very big amount of things. It means that you need execution context. It means that it can raise errors. It means that it executes asynchronously. It's too much power, and you don't need all of this power in your day-to-day code. So yeah, and okay. I want to add that also. The inspiration for this talk was this context propagation, and I don't want all my code to be aware about context. So, and I can hide it behind this F. So I don't, and I don't need to explicitly write everywhere either the future context string or either the future context something. I just write F and that's all. So.
Thank you for your talk. And my question is, what if you're using some kind of library, for example, Slick, that which uses future as an part of its API? So how can I handle this using your approach?
Okay, so Cats Effect, it's a library for handling effects. It has a type class called async that has a combinator, which means that you can put any callback API into IO and into some F, because it's an instance for some F. So there is a, in Cats Effect, there is a type class that can put your callback API, like future, in F. So that's all. And in fact, in Dubi, Dubi is the scene wrapper around JDBC. It's built on top of free algebra. And in the end, you need to interpret this free algebra in some F. So in Dubi, it's first class support. You just write in that you transact your queries, your selects, your inserts in the F, and that's all. You don't need to manually wrap it like in Slick or in us.
Okay, thank you.